In today's video, I'm going to be explaining what eye floaters are, and I'm going to be trying to make it as simple as possible to understand. Hey, you're watching Martin's Eye Tips with me, Martin Oguzi. If you're new here, welcome to the channel. I'm a UK-based optometrist and I've been an optometrist now for about 20 years. You're in the right place for the best eye care tips, product reviews and how-to videos, all designed to help you see better, see more comfortably and have less anxiety about your eyes. So go ahead and subscribe to the channel, hit the notification bell to make sure you get notified every time I release a new video. So to make this video as simple as possible to understand, we're going to have a look at first of all what floaters look like, then we'll have a look at where they appear in the eye, and then we'll have a look at why you get them in the first place. Now floaters actually appear in a variety of different forms. You may well find that your floaters may look like a strand of hair or a particle or flies, sometimes people describe them, and you may initially find that you're swatting them, just trying to get them out of your way because you don't realize initially that it's actually in your eye and not outside of your eye. Now when floaters first appear in your vision, it's quite a natural thing to be frightened or scared by what's going on, because it just seems quite an unnatural thing to have these particles in your vision, and most people will be concerned about what it means for their vision in the future and whether it's something that's going to get worse. But standard floaters are very common, and the fact that you've got one doesn't mean you're going to get another one straight away, but it is likely that you may get a few more in the future, so be aware of that. Now within the eyeball is a large central space, and it's this central space that has this special fluid that we call the vitreous gel or the vitreous humor, which is where floaters appear. Now the reason that we have this fluid here in the first place is really to serve two main functions. First of all, it keeps the retina in place. Without the fluid in there, if there was no fluid in there, your retina, which is not firmly held onto the eye, may peel off. So it helps to kind of just add a bit of pressure that keeps everything in place, that keeps your blood vessels in place and stops everything collapsing in. It also helps to serve as a shock absorber from external or outside forces. So, for example, if you poke yourself in the eye or something hits you in the eye, then it absorbs some of this impact that comes and passes through the eye. So it's there as a protective mechanism. So why do we get floaters in the first place? Well, the vitreous fluid is made 99% out of water, and then it's got a 1%, which is a combination of collagen, some vitreous cells, and also some supporting molecules as well. Now to try and simulate and also to just show a little bit more simply the difference between a normal vitreous and a vitreous which has degenerated a little bit more and now has floaters, I've gone ahead and made up a couple of mock-ups with a fluid inside of a balloon. So we have two balloons. The first one is going to be representing the normal eyeball. And with this balloon, we can see that the fluid is nice and firm. There's very little movement, if any at all, in this balloon here. So as I rotate the balloon around, just like the human eye would rotate around, the little bubbles which you might be able to see, they don't really move and the fluid doesn't move. Therefore, any kind of shadows that may be cast onto the retina is constant and is constantly cast in the same position on the retina all the time. These little bubbles, we can take them to kind of represent the collagen fibers which exist in the eye anyway, and under normal circumstances the kind of molecules that support the vitreous fluid, they help to space out the collagen fibers nice and evenly, and allows the eye to be perfectly transparent without any clumping of the collagen fibers. Now the difference in an eye with floater, what we find is that the fluid moves a bit more, and you can see the kind of ever ball that's created here, and that would kind of be like the situation where you've got a shrinkage of or degeneration of some of the supporting molecules, and now the fluid is not really packed out fully in the eye, so there's more movement, and as a result you get clumping together of collagen fibers which lead to these floaters that are more visible. And the floaters now, because they move around, they cast a shadow onto the retina, onto the back of the eye, that also moves. And it's these shadows that become visible to you and become the annoying floaters that we see. So as part of normal aging, we're going to get this disintegration of the fluid, the vitreous fluid, which leads to more movement in the eye. It leads to sticking together of these collagen fibers, which then appear as specks and particles and almost like strands of hair. And you start to see that shadow in your eye as they move around. You also find that the floaters themselves don't tend to move in, you know, all over the place. They tend to stay within a certain area. So you might move your eye to the left and the shadow kind of follows and trails behind. And then you put your look straight ahead and the floater moves back into position as well. And that's because the jelly is still relatively stable and everything is moving within a small area of space. So for the most part, age is the main reason why you're going to get floaters, because of this natural kind of shrinkage of the fluid and this disintegration of some of those supporting molecules that I talked about. But you know, you can get floaters at a younger age as well. Essentially, anything that takes that makes the fluid in your eye, that the vitreous jelly, more mobile. And you know, can lead to the risk of you getting floaters. And that may be the reason why people who are short-sighted, very highly short-sighted people, or people who don't have short-sightedness but are young may also get floaters as well. So anything that can cause, for example, head trauma, you know, for example, if you're into boxing quite a lot, or you play a lot of football, soccer, and you head the ball a lot, then you could potentially have a situation where you kind of create a coming away of this kind of structure and create motion within it, which then may lead to slight clumping together of collagen, and also it can create movement in the collagen, which then leads to floaters becoming more visible. Now there's a whole lot we could say about floaters, and we can get into a lot more detail about how it all works and be a lot more precise about the kind of the biology of it all and the kind of science involved, but I hope you agree that was you know, a fairly straightforward way to understand how floaters work. You know, so if you care to share your experiences with floaters, then you know, I'd really love to know in the comment section whether you've got floaters, how long you've had your floaters for, what kind of problems that you might have experienced with floaters, you know, and you know, any questions that you might have as well, that might help somebody else, or any questions that you might want to throw at me as well. So take care, and I'll see you in the next video.